Won't you spare me over till another year? Well, what is this that I can't see with ice cold hands taking hold of me? Well, I am deaf, none can excel. I'll open the door to heaven or hell. Oh, deaf, someone would pray, could you wait to call me another day? The children prayed, the preacher preached, time and mercy is out of your reach. I'll fix your feet so you can't walk. I'll lock your jaw so you can't talk. I'll close your eyes so you can't see. This very hour, come go with me. Death, I come to take the soul, leave the body and leave it cold. To drop the flesh up off the frame, dirt and worm both have a claim. Oh, oh, death. Whoa. Won't you spare me over till another year? My mother came to my bed, placed a cold towel up in my head. My heart is warm, my feet are cold, death is moving up on my soul. Oh, death, how you're treating me. You close my eyes so I can't see. Well, you hurt my body, you make me cold, you turn my life right out of my soul. Oh, death, please consider my age, please don't take me at this stage. My wealth is all at your command, if you will move your icy hand. Oh, the young, the rich or poor, how will like me no more? No wealth, no land, no silver, no gold, nothing satisfies me but your soul. Won't you spare me over till another year? Won't you spare me over till another year? Won't you spare me over till another year?
Good afternoon. And welcome to this Good Friday service of worship broadcast live via live stream from the meeting house of the Presbyterian Church of Lawrenceville. As I listen to the wind whistle past the meeting house and rattle the shutters, I'm aware of all the saints who've been part of this community of faith. They're with us. You are with us, assembled together at a distance, and we are together God's people at worship. We hope that this telling of the story of Jesus' suffering, his passion, will be useful to you in your spiritual journey. And as you appropriate this story and make meaning of it and relate it to the death dealing that continues in our world today, we hope also that you will join us for the end of the story. On Sunday morning, we will be broadcasting a sunrise service from the graveyard at 6:15 and our festival service at 10 a.m., of course, both live streamed via Facebook Live. I want to give thanks for those who made this service possible. The musicians, Beau Child, Mark Hill, Jim Moyer, Rich Richards, Dr. Trenise Robinson-Martin, John Timpane, Catherine Thomas, and worship leaders Kyle Anderson, who is responsible for this service, Jill Cifelli, Reverend Dr. Louise Johnson, and yours truly. Let us worship God together and prepare our hearts and minds to hear once again the sacred story.
2, 3, 4. This is the cross that held the Savior of the world. Oh, this is the cross that held the Savior of the world. Oh, oh. This is the cross that held the Savior of the world. Oh, this is the cross that held the Savior of the world.
I invite you to join me this morning in our call to worship. You'll find the response there on the screen in just a moment. Let us pray. O my people, O my church, what more could I have done for you? Answer me. I led you out of slavery into freedom and delivered you through the waters of rebirth, but you have made a cross for your Savior. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. I led you on your way in a pillar of cloud and fire, but you led me to the judgment hall of Pilate. I guided you by the light of the Holy Spirit, but you have made a cross for your Savior. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. I gave you a royal scepter, but you gave me a crown of thorns. I gave you the kingdom and crowned you with eternal life, but you have made a cross for your Savior. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. I struck down your enemies, but you struck my head with a reed. I gave you my peace, but you draw a sword in my name, and you have made a cross for your Savior. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. I opened the waters to lead you to the promised land, but you opened my side with a spear. I washed your feet as a sign of my love, but you have made a cross for your Savior. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. I grafted you into my people Israel, that you have made them scapegoats for your own guilt, and you have made a cross for your Savior. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. Amen.
Remember, Lord, our mortal state, how frail our lives, how short the day. Where is the man that draws his breath, safe from death?
Jesus and his friends were all together for dinner. They were having a good time. It was just like any other night, and no one had any reason to suspect otherwise. It is, of course, until Jesus said something that was unfathomable. One of you will betray me. His words were piercing. They seemed to leave his lips in slow motion and hang there in the air. Silence. The kind of silence that you could feel filled the room, except for the dull ringing in the disciples' ears. What did he say? Confusion isn't the right word. Shock even doesn't begin to describe how they were feeling. In the midst of this internal kind of chaos, Jesus turned to Judas, whose hand was still on the cup that they shared, and he said to him, "Hurry, go and do what you must do." Clearly overcome by emotion, Judas got up from the table and he ran out of the room. Consumed by their thoughts, the others missed it. They didn't get it. How could one of us betray Jesus? It was as if time had stopped. They were still trying to make sense of those six words. 3 years they had spent together. These friends. This family. Jesus knew when to push his disciples. He knew when they needed to be challenged. But he also knew when they needed time to process what he had just said. And so it's almost as if they weren't there. He began to pray. Jesus prayed often. He was passionate with his prayers, and his words were powerful, but this time it was different. Jesus wasn't praying for the world. He was praying for his friends. There was something more intimate about this prayer. There was a deep sense of love in his voice. When he had finished praying, they decided to go for a walk together, a change of scenery. It was still early enough in the evening that the path was still visible. The sky was clear. Usually there is a soft breeze in the air, but not tonight. It was as if all of creation was holding its breath right along with them. They silently crossed the valley just outside of the city, and they entered a garden there. It was a place that they had gone to often. It was a place where they had spent time together as a group and even as individuals to retreat. There was something almost therapeutic about being in a familiar place. Their fond memories there provided a sense of comfort that each of them didn't even know they needed. The mood in the group began to change slowly, like exhaling after holding your breath for a while. Things were almost normal again. Suddenly, they were confronted with Jesus' words once more. But this time, they came as the sound of boots marching and clanking armor. Then as the light from lanterns and torches, "Stay here," Jesus told them as he made his way back over toward the gate. There before him stood a whole mob of Roman soldiers and guards from the religious leaders. "Who are you looking for?" Jesus shouted. "Jesus of Nazareth," the mob replied. There was a kind of pregnant pause before Jesus responded, "I am." Surely he must have been afraid, but his voice didn't betray his emotions one bit. His words were just as piercing as they had been before. And though he was buried somewhere in the center of the crowd, Jesus knew that Judas was there also. When Jesus responded, "I am," the mob moved and shifted just enough that his eyes met Judas. "Who are you looking for?" Jesus shouted again, but this time his gaze never left Judas. Tears began to well up in Judas's eyes. He didn't respond with the crowd. He couldn't respond. "Jesus of Nazareth," replied the crowd once more, but this time even more confident. By this time, the disciples, who were never really good at following directions, were all standing right there behind Jesus. But for the first time that night, they were concretely rooted in reality, fully present, fully aware of what was happening. Judas stepped forward, and with a hopeful look in his eye, he leaned in and he kissed Jesus on the cheek. That was it. That was the sign. That's how they knew the one to arrest. And so one of the guards, Malchus, stepped forward to arrest Jesus. By now, all the disciples were wearing their emotions on their sleeve. Peter, who was visibly angry, shouted, "Get away from him!" Peter didn't actually have a plan. This was more of an emotional reaction, an outburst. Throwing himself between the mob and Jesus, he drew a dagger from under his robe and he cut off the guard's ear. Jesus put his hand on Peter's shoulder. His voice was much softer. "Peter, put the dagger away," Jesus said, "Am I not to drink the cup the Father has given?" And with that, the mob, the soldiers, the commander, and the guards bound Jesus, and they took him into custody. With tears in their eyes, Jesus' friends were overcome by emotion, and they fell to their knees.
Two, three, four.
Spent the night being dragged from one chief priest's house to another to be questioned. The religious leaders were afraid of Jesus. Jesus was a problem they needed to solve before droves of people, including followers of Jesus, made their way to Jerusalem for Passover. This was their one shot. Truth be told, they didn't have a valid reason to arrest Jesus in the first place. But now that they had him, they were hoping they could force him to say something that would get him in trouble. And of course, Jesus gave them nothing. By now, it was early in the morning, and this mock trial had gone on for hours. Everyone was tired. Tired and frustrated himself, Caiaphas, the chief priest, knew he had to play this carefully. Maybe if he brought Jesus before the Roman governor, the Roman authorities would take over. Problem solved. The Romans had made Pilate governor and commanded him to maintain order in Jerusalem. It wasn't a prestigious post by any means, but it wasn't without its opportunities. If Pilate did a good job, he might even receive a promotion and find a better position in Rome. That was a dream that was about to be challenged. Pilate, who had been sleeping peacefully in his bed, was startled awake by one of his servants. "Sir, you're needed immediately. There's a group of men at the gate, and they have a prisoner with them." "Who's at the gate? And what do they want? They have a prisoner?" The Jewish religious leaders were the ones at the gate. They couldn't enter the palace because it would make them ritually impure, and hence unable to participate in Passover worship. There is an irony here, of course, namely that these religious leaders were more concerned about their own purity than they were about the injustice of bringing false charges against Jesus. Reluctantly, Pilate put on his robe and went out to meet them. He didn't want all of the details, and quite frankly, at this hour, he didn't care. And so he cut right to the chase. "What charge do you bring against this man, Jesus?" Well, they didn't have a charge, remember? They were winging this whole thing. "If he had done nothing wrong," they said, "we wouldn't have brought Jesus to you." Well, that wasn't an answer, not one that Pilate was satisfied with anyway, and so he said, take him yourselves and judge him according to your own religious law. They had already tried that. They had spent all night trying that, and it didn't work. They had to come up with something. Suddenly, one of the men shouted back, we are Jews. Our law doesn't allow us to kill anyone. And just like that, it was out there. They couldn't take it back. They looked at one another, and then they looked back towards Pilate. Pilate was looking at Jesus. This was the last thing Pilate needed. He couldn't risk a riot with Passover around the corner. And so with a loud exhale, he turned around and went back inside. After several minutes, Pilate called for Jesus. Pilate's frustration was palpable. Who are you? And why are your people turning you over to me? What did you do? Are you a king or not? Jesus waited for Pilate to finish before answering, I am a king, but my kingdom is not of this world. I came into the world so that I could bear witness to the truth. Everyone who cares for truth, anyone who has any sense of the truth, recognizes my voice. What is truth? Pilate asked. And with that, he turned and went back outside to the religious leaders. He wanted a quick end to this whole thing before it got out of hand. Look, Pilate said, I don't find any fault in this man. It's your custom that I pardon one prisoner at Passover. Why don't I just pardon him? But the religious leaders were determined to get rid of Jesus, and so they shouted back, no, no, not him. We want Barabbas. Barabbas was a rebel, a Jewish freedom fighter, and a murderer. In other words, they were telling Pilate, you can pardon anyone but Jesus. Pilate knew he was getting nowhere. Even if he didn't understand it, the religious leaders were hell-bent on having Jesus punished. He could see it in their eyes and hear it in their voices. It was clear Pilate wasn't going to make it back to bed. So Pilate took Jesus and had him whipped and beaten. For extra measure, the soldiers stripped Jesus naked. They braided a crown of thorns and they pulled it down on his head, tearing his flesh. They threw a torn piece of purple fabric over his shoulders to represent a robe and mocked him, shouting, Hail, King of the Jews! They spit on him and slapped him in the face. They added insult to injury. They humiliated him. And then they dragged him back out before the religious leaders. Here's your king, Pilate announced. But before he could say anything else, the crowd broke into a frenzy, shouting, Crucify him! Crucify him! You take him. You crucify him, Pilate said. I've found nothing wrong with him. And with that, Pilate dipped his hands into a bowl of water, and he dried them with a towel, and then he showed them to the crowd, saying, My hands are clean of this. It's you who are crucifying him.
Back and forth all morning, the religious leaders and Pilate and Jesus. By now it was noon. "Don't you know that I have the power to release you or to crucify you? Give me something." Pilate was begging Jesus to give him a reason, any reason to release him and put this whole thing to bed. But just as before, Jesus said nothing. The crowd outside became more of a mob that seemed to be growing. Their cries were deafening. Pilate's heart thumped away in his throat. He had planned just to release Jesus, but the mob no longer waited to hear what Jesus had to say. There could be only one outcome that would satisfy them. "Crucify him! Crucify him!" they yelled even louder. "Crucify your king?" Pilate shouted. "We have no king but Caesar," some yelled. "Anyone who claims to be king is a rebel against Caesar," others shouted. This was a political move. Pilate was stuck, and he knew it. And so he caved in to their demands, and they got what they wanted. Crucifixions took place outside the walls of the city. Death was a dirty business, better safe than sorry. So the soldiers stripped Jesus down once more. They removed the purple robe and the crown of thorns, and they forced him to carry his own cross down the sandstone streets, through the city gate, and up to Skull Hill, where he would be crucified. The cross was made up of two heavy pieces of lumber. The wood was rough and splintered. It ripped into Jesus's already torn flesh. It would have been hard for anyone to carry, let alone someone who had been whipped and beaten within an inch of his life. "Get up! Move!" a soldier yelled. With whatever strength he could find, Jesus inched along the road. His breathing was labored. His body was shutting down. Crowds were already gathered along the road. Some were throwing food scraps and garbage, mocking Jesus and shouting. But most were silent. There to his left, Jesus saw his friend John and his mother with him. There was a look of terror in John's eyes and a tear running down his mother's face. But Jesus didn't say a word. John and Mary didn't say a word. Finally, Jesus made it to Skull Hill. The soldiers laid him on the cross and nailed him to it. But before they could hoist the cross into place, they heard a voice running towards them. "Wait! Wait!" one soldier shouted. He had a sign in his hand. "The governor wants this nailed to that cross." The sign said, "Jesus the Nazarene, King of the Jews." The religious leaders wanted editing rights. They would have preferred it to say something like, "He said he was King of the Jews." But Pilate was making a point. It was as if he was saying, "You know what you did." With his family watching and surrounded by strangers, soldiers, and religious leaders, Jesus was crucified.
Dolorosa in Jerusalem that day. The soldiers tried to clear the narrow street, but the crowds pressed in to see the man condemned to die on Calvary. He was bleeding from a beating. There were stripes upon his back, and he wore a crown of thorns upon his head. And he bore with every step the scorn of those who cried out for his death. Down the Via Dolorosa, called the way of suffering, like the lamb came the Christ the King. But he chose to walk that road out of his love for you and me. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way to Calvary. Por la Via Dolorosa, please, Delia in Jerusalem, los soldados le abren paso a Jesús. Mas la gente se acercaba para ver a quien llevaba aquella cruz. Por la vida, por la rosa, quien se le vino del dolor, como rey vino Cristo. Sorry.
This is the breaking, when the very ground seems to crumble, because this is what it means to be forsaken. Scream, but no one will hear, so save your breath for your last 3, 2. And your bones seem to split and fracture as every face that once loved you howls like a hunter, and you are the prey. I tell you to pray and see if that will make it better. Pray to the God who left you. 3, 2. I do not wish this on you. To feel your body destroyed, your joints disintegrate, your mouth dry up, your blood pour out, and all the while the crowd looming, waiting for you to crack. This is the breaking. When the betrayals and the denials cannot be taken back, and you are alone. Will those stones cry out now? Will those angels carry me now? No. 3, 2. I will pray to the God who left me, because what else is there to do? No one else is listening either. Do not save me. I am gone. Save them. Forgive them. Save them. 3, 2, 1. Jesus took his last breath and died. This is the breaking.
Two, three, four.
Dark. The clouds had moved in and the sky was dark. But it was more than that. There was a feeling of darkness. It was dark. By now, most of the crowds had left. The spectacle of crucifixion was over and everyone returned back to their lives as if nothing happened. But something did happen. An innocent man was murdered. He's dead. He's gone. this man who is so full of life, so full of love. This man who was the Son of God, he is dead. He's gone. John and Mary were still there. Of course they were. They weren't going anywhere. There were two or three strangers there with them and a small company of soldiers, just enough to lower the cross and remove Jesus' body from it. "Be careful, that's my son," shouted Mary. The soldiers barely noticed her as they continued to pull the nails from Jesus' hands and from his feet. Just then, one of the strangers made his way toward the soldiers. He had a piece of parchment in his hand and he gave it to one of them. Their conversation was inaudible, but with a nod, the soldier handed the parchment back. And suddenly another man appeared there with him. His hands were full. He was carrying a mixture of myrrh and aloes. It must have weighed 75 pounds at least. It's possible that this man had been there the whole time. It's just that everyone's attention had been on Jesus. He looked familiar to John, but he couldn't seem to put a name to his face. Everything must have been in order, because the two men turned their attention toward Mary and toward John. "Are you his mother?" the first man asked. "My name is Joseph, from Arimathea. I followed your son and I listened to him preach." "This is Nicodemus," he said, pointing to the other man. "Pilate gave us permission to receive his body," Nicodemus said. "It's almost sundown. We have to hurry." John and Mary didn't quite know what they were saying. The grief and the trauma of the whole thing left them kind of fuzzy. Just there, below Skull Hill, was a garden. And there in the garden, there were a few graves, but this was by no means a cemetery. There was a small cave there in the rocks that could be used as a kind of makeshift tomb. It was open, and it was convenient. And so, as quickly as they could, the two men prepared Jesus' body, and they laid him there in that tomb. There was no celebration of his life. There was no mourning his death. Where were his friends? They deserted him. They denied him and they left him to die alone. Surely Jesus deserves better than this. In silence, they left Jesus' body there and they returned to their home.
The night weeps and covers the earth with her protective arms, whispering, "I will hold you." The skies crack and the earth groans as God dies. And the wilderness is truly empty. And there is nothing but silence, the kind of silence that comes when there is no more point in breathing. And yet somehow the rest of us still go on. Breathe with us, O earth. Breathe with us, O sky. Breathe with us, O night. Stay with us as we wait, as we wait, as we wait.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Oh, sometimes it comes me to tremble. Were you there when they crucified my Lord?